Before I turn it over to our amazing moderator for tonight's panel, I just want to quickly introduce myself and place tonight's event in a bit of context. So hello again, my name is Kristen Bush, and I am the Director of Student and Alumni Affairs at the School of Global Public Health. And tonight, this is actually our second annual Black History Month event. The second time that we are doing a Succeeding While Black event, this time highlighting amazing, phenomenal Black young alumni who are just making strides across the field. I mean, I don't know if any of you had a chance to read these amazing women's bios. If you didn't, you'll hear from them tonight, but I almost fell out of my seat reading them. And even in preparing for this, the message that came to me is that you women are our ancestors' greatest dream, greatest prayer realized. And so to be here with you tonight, on this particular occasion for Black History Month, celebrating it, I am honored, and I know everyone else is as well. Please give them some love. Thank you so much, Jennifer Bryant. I can already see you giving love. Please give these phenomenal women love, either, you know, by clapping in the chat, because they definitely deserve it. So before we move on, I just also want to say, we are joined here by students and alumni. We even have our president of our alumni association. If you want to turn on your camera really quick, Samara, wave to the folks. She is joining us. And she is joining us because our alumni association, not only did they just launch last year in 2020, but they have been active. They have been busy. They have amazingness coming up and coming on. So definitely be checking your emails if you are alumni for the upcoming events that they have. Additionally, we have some career events coming up for students. Next week, we are going to be having a career fair where you can actually begin your path, as many of these women did their second year, or even an undergrad. If you're an undergrad, you can begin your path into these fields by attending our career fair. And Sierra, our moderator, will be saying more soon. So without further ado, I am going to make sure that I introduce Sierra. While I'm doing this, if you want to go ahead and put your year in the chat, as well as, you know, where you're joining us from the world, that would be great. So our moderator tonight is Sierra Freeman. She is a first year MPH student with a concentration in global health. She has a bachelor's degree in communication studies and journalism from Loyola Marymount University in California. And presently, she works with NYU's Global Public Health Student Affairs Office as a career and alumni graduate specialist, and has previously assisted NYU's Global Action for Urban Health Lab. Additionally, she has interned for Beach Cities Health District and gained experience with data collection, policy development, and business recovery in the wake of COVID-19. She also serves as vice president of NYU's Black Women's Health Collective, which I'm super excited because one of our panelists, she's shaking, you might see her, is actually the founder of that organization. So you have one of your grandchildren here tonight. This is the power of our communities, right? And the power of our leadership. Like, look how it pays it forward to the next generation. So thank you so much, Sierra. I will be handing it over to you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, Kristen. Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. I see we have a lot of Brooklyn natives in the house. That's awesome. Great. So thank you all so much for investing your time with us this evening. Again, my name is Sierra and I will serve as the moderator for this event. We have an amazing panel, as you know, Succeeding While Black, the Young Alumni Real Talk and Mixer. And today we'll just be talking about the career experiences of our panelists, you know, how they got to where they are, as well as some tips and tricks relevant to a variety of focuses within the public health field. So whatever concentration you're in, I'm sure we'll discuss it and we will have that represented. Our goal today is that whatever your interests are in this industry, that you will come away with something, whether it's a new idea or a fresh perspective, something that you can apply now to prepare yourself for your career after your program. So here's the format to give you sort of an idea of what to expect. First, we'll take a few moments for each of the panelists to briefly introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about their background in the industry. Funke will go first, followed by Khadija, then Shalom and Deborah. And I will kick off the conversation, asking questions that draw out some of the high level themes and trends that we should be thinking about. And then with the second half of our time today, we'll open up the floor to give you an opportunity to ask specific questions that you've been thinking about to help you navigate some of the opportunities and challenges to be more intentional with your time moving forward. So does that sound good? If so, we'll go ahead and get started with the panel introductions. So first we have Funke. If you'd like to go ahead and introduce yourself.
Thanks, Sierra. Hi, my name is Funke Jenikoko, and I'm a program officer for nutrition and surveillance at Resolve to Save Lives, which is an initiative of Vital Strategies. And basically the aim of my initiative is to save 100 million lives from cardiovascular disease through implementation of hypertension treatment and control programs, eliminating trans fat from the global food supply, and then implementing sodium reduction policies and interventions within LMICs and also at the global level. So working with partners like WHO and the Global Health Advocacy Incubator, and I'm just happy to be here and see a bunch of people I have not seen in a while. So hi, everyone.
Wonderful. Nice to meet you, Funke. And next we have Khadija.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Khadija Davis, and I'm a 2019 graduate of the College of Global Public Health. I was on the SBF track, and currently I serve as a press officer at Planned Parenthood Federation of America, which is the national office of our organization. And so in my role, I provide communication support to affiliates across the country who together make Planned Parenthood the largest provider of sexual and reproductive health care and sex education in the country. So I'm so excited to be here and can't wait for more of the conversation.
Wonderful. Glad to have you. Next we have Shalom.
Hi guys, so good to see everyone. So excited to be here today. My name is Shalom. I finished in 2018 on the global health track. I currently work as a healthcare consultant, specifically I do a lot of data analysis and policy work. I specifically work with the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, where we do a lot of work around managing and tracking the returns on investment for the organization on innovations that they have to reduce fraud, waste, and abuse in the system. It would surprise you to know how much fraudulent activities go on in the system. So every day I just crunch a lot of data, provide policies that policy movements that help drive the actions of the entire system. So yeah.
Wow, awesome. Thank you. And finally, we have Deborah.
Hi guys, nice to see everyone. I'm Deborah Anokomaya. I graduated in 2018 and my track was in global health. Currently, I'm a first year PhD student in the population health track at the Vilcek Institute of Biomedical Research at NYU Langone. Prior to that, I was a senior program coordinator in the section for global health at NYU Langone. So a lot of the work I did was working with stakeholders in a lot of countries abroad, specifically in sub-Saharan Africa. And our focus was around hypertension research and using implementation science to combat the high burden of hypertension in those regions. So through that experience, I've been exposed to a lot of research around implementation science, a lot of research in hypertension, and that really led, my interest into seeking further education through a PhD. So I'm glad to be here. I see a lot of people in the chat, and let's get this started.
Awesome. Yes, real Black girl magic indeed. Yes, we love that. Okay, awesome. So we can just start with giving us sort of an overview of each of your journeys to the global public health field and sort of what the day-to-day of your job looks like. If we could start with Funke and we'll go in order.
Yeah, sure. So I actually have a bachelor's degree in dietetics. So after I graduated from undergrad, I worked in the clinical nutrition space. So I actually was a nutritionist for the Women, Infant, and Children program for Dallas County in Texas. And primarily my job there was to do nutrition, education, and counseling, as well as diet prescriptions. And when I was there, I realized that there's so many things that play into people's abilities to eat a healthy diet. And counseling, yes, is helpful so people know what they should eat, but if they can't afford it, they don't have access to it, what does this information really do for them? So I decided to go back to school and get my master's degree in public health with a concentration on nutrition, so I could work on nutrition at the population level and create change within the government to make sure that people actually have access and the ability to eat healthy foods. So in my current role, that's kind of what I'm doing. I work with my team to create nutrition policies in low and middle income countries. For me, I manage a couple different countries. So I am our point of contact for Nigeria, where we are trying to implement some front of pack labeling on processed foods so people know whether they're high in salt, sugar, or trans fat, as well as doing some public food procurement work. So trying to create standards in schools for what can be served to children. And then I also serve as the point of contact for the Philippines, Vietnam, and then for some of our global work around nutrition. My day-to-day, oh God, it looks different every day. I think one thing that people would be surprised about is I spend a ton of time writing technical documents. So drafting policies for governments, drafting kind of like standard information for anyone who wants to implement some kind of nutrition program in countries. So knowing what steps they need to take in order to get policies passed. Doing a lot of like resource sharing and advocacy work. So creating documents around that as well. So I think like 90% of my job is actually writing things. yeah.
Wonderful. Would you say that the reality of your job, which includes writing and drafting these documents, would you say that, how does this compare to people's idealized expectations of what your role may entail?
I think when people hear like, oh, you're a program officer working in the global space, they think you're jet setting around the world, that you're really being on ground working with governments, like, oh, you should do this, that, and the third. That's not real. I'm not the person on the ground actually implementing the work. I'm the person in the background kind of trying to help the people on the ground push their agenda forward. And I think a lot of people don't recognize that's what you do as a program officer. You're really in the background just trying to figure out, how can I move this work forward? How can I get this policy at the forefront of this the government's mind? How can I just affect change?
Wonderful, awesome. So next we can go on to, we can go continue in order. We can go to Khadija and ask her the same question. Sort of what's the day-to-day of your job, how you came to study what you did, and how the reality of your job compares to people's idealized expectations.
So I started my career in health communications actually in 2015, which was immediately after I graduated from undergrad. I had studied healthcare policy and management, African American studies, and I had always was always good at writing. And so I wanted to do something where I could like marry healthcare with writing and just use my talents that way. And so when I started, I was working at a global communications agency called Weber Shandwick, where I was doing communications for pharmaceutical companies like Roche and Genentech and Eli Lilly, who at the time were rolling out different medicines to treat conditions like multiple sclerosis, hemophilia, hypoglycemia. And I did that for about 4 years. And that really helped ground me in a lot of the fundamentals of healthcare and like science communications, but I wasn't super passionate about the actual work that I was doing. And so that's actually what triggered me to go back to grad school at that point and I found myself at NYU. And because I really wanted to work in the advocacy or like patient facing side of healthcare communications. And I also knew that I was interested in reproductive health and specifically in improving outcomes for Black women and girls. So I ended up at NYU and I had opportunities to intern globally, study abroad, which is really cool, and really use that time to build up my background in maternal and child health and even sexual and reproductive health and equity through the coursework and projects that I was doing. And while at NYU, I also co-founded Black Women's Health Imperative with Allison, who's also here today. And that was intended to be a space to provide Black women at NYU a space to talk about issues as it relates to health in Black women and girls. And so a few months after graduating is when I actually started my role. And I've been here for almost a year and a half now at Planned Parenthood. In terms of the day-to-day, I would say that work changes for me every day, just like Mkay said. A good part of my role is dictated by what's going on in the world, what people are talking about on social media, on TV, in the news, like that can really change how, like what we're doing. Another chunk of my time is spent building media strategies, and that could be for campaigns and brand partnerships, upcoming health observances, changes in our medical guidance, research publications that our affiliates are working on. And I also spend a really good bit of my time writing talking points and training spokespeople within the organization so that they could talk to reporters to get all of our messages across. I pitch media to cover topics that we want to lift up. I do a lot of reporter education because sometimes when they reach out, they don't always know what to ask. They know they want to write something, but they don't know what to write about. And so doing a lot of work to shape their stories, writing press releases, editing fact sheets, all types of stuff. When you ask though how people idealize communication, I'm not really sure how they idealize it, but I can tell you it can be really fast paced and it requires a lot of thinking, a lot of planning, a lot of writing and doing it pretty quickly because things change pretty quickly. I also will say that communications can be really, really fun to do. We get to work with some pretty cool partners and influencers to get our messages out to different audiences. And in normal times, we get to plan events, travel to our different affiliates and work with media and the spokespeople there. We get to meet with reporters and synergize and do a lot more in person. So there's a lot of variety in what you're gonna be doing and your day-to-day never, ever, ever looks the same.
That must be fun, having the varied, such a varied job and role. And next we will go on to Shalom.
Okay, I think my path has been a very interesting one. I finished my undergrad in like 2012 and I finished with a BSc in biochemistry and then like went straight into pharma and did pharma for a few months and just got like fed up with the whole thing. And then I went into IT consulting. So I was working as a project manager in like an IT consulting firm doing all of this business analysis work, consulting work for like finance companies. And I mean, also like for healthcare companies as well. Deep down, I knew I wanted to do like more like meaningful work. I mean, it wasn't that what I was doing wasn't great, but then I wanted to do something that like touched the lives of people that I could be like, this is not just about the money or like, you know, all of that. And then that was why like I pursued a master's in public health and NYU was my choice. And then afterwards, I got this job where I work as like a healthcare consultant. Technically, I do a lot of data and policy work, like I said earlier. I mean, I've worked in consulting for a long time. And I think for the most part, a lot of people think of consulting as more like strategy work, which it is. You know, it's a lot of like talking, it's a lot of like convincing people that the way you think it is the best way and not the way they think it should be. But then I think in today's world, especially if you're doing healthcare consulting work, like all of your talk has to be backed up by data. Like you just cannot like wake up and say, oh, I think you should formulate this policy just because I went to like NYU or because I have a degree from Harvard. You have to be like, oh, this is what the data says and this is how I think this should be done. And I think, you know, when I was at NYU, I was in global health, but like, you know, there was just something that made me pursue like more like data and analysis courses. And I think that was like genuinely like what has helped me to be where I am today. Because I mean, before I would think of things like a little differently, but now I think more like analytically, like, you know, what is the data saying and how can that translate into policy? So my day-to-day, like I spend the most of my time crunching large sets of like claims data, which to be honest is not very exciting. And I think like, you know, when I got this job, I was like, oh, I'll perform all this analysis. But then like, you find out that you spend 80% of your time cleaning data because people don't know how to put data in correctly. So like, I feel like, you know, there's this idealistic view of what a data analyst is, but for the most part, you spend your time cleaning all this data to be able to like do the kind of like research work that you want to do using the data. So yeah, I mean, that's what I do for the most part. And then I write a bunch of like policies, present it to the client, and then do the whole talking involved in consulting and trying to convince them that, you know, this is what we think is the best approach, you know, to solving this particular problem. So yeah.
Very interesting. Thank you for sharing, Shalom. We'll get back to you. And finally, we have Deborah.
Yeah, so I mean, how did I come to public health? So I had an undergrad in biochemistry. And after that, I taught for a couple of years. So I taught high school biology for a couple of years. And it wasn't really for me. I just kind of found myself in that. And in general, as young as I can remember, I've always wanted to be a doctor. I've always wanted to be in that healthcare space. And I wasn't sure like where I would go by not going just to medical school. So while I was teaching, I started just looking up degrees in different graduate schools. And I came across a master's in public health and I wasn't sure what that was. So I did a little bit more research. I talked to my sister about it. And it was something that, you know, wasn't necessarily in the medical field, but related, like an allied profession to the medical field. So that's kind of how I got interested in that. I applied to a bunch of schools, about 15 schools, and NYU accepted me, which I was very happy about. And I was in the global health track for that. While I was in school, I did a ton of internships. I interned everywhere. So it was really just to get my feet wet in understanding what the space was about, specifically with global health. Particularly, I had looked into epidemiology and global health, and I was really interested in some of the things that I could do with global health. And luckily enough, after I graduated, I was employed at the medical school as a senior program coordinator. So a lot of the work I was doing was working with international partners, you know, coordinating some of the projects in there, on site, going to different countries, talking to them, understanding their context, doing things like needs assessments in that regard. And really a huge part of my job as a program coordinator was managing NIH grants. So by the time I had worked a couple of years as a senior program coordinator, I became interested, as I had mentioned earlier, in research. So that caused me to pursue a higher degree, which is what I'm currently doing as a doctoral student. So in terms of the day-to-day as a doctoral student, I'm going to answer it together in terms of the day-to-day and what people expect. So I myself had preconceived notions about what a PhD might look like. I felt it'll be like my MPH where I'm just going to classes, maybe intern here and there, but it's completely different, right? So a major chunk of your work is actually research. So you have to be, either you're working on a data set, you're writing a paper, you're doing a review. So a large chunk of my time is really either working with colleagues on some data, creating a project, writing a grant, and classes are like at the bottom of my totem pole. A lot of the classes I'm attending are really classes to improve and sharpen whatever skills I want to use for my research. So I had preconceived notions about that. And slowly I'm realizing that the chunk of what it is to be in a PhD program is really, doing that research. It's like someone threw you into the deep end and you're just learning how to swim. So there's so much going on all at the same time. And a key thing about the PhD program is mentorship, right? So as I'm in that program, I'm also looking for mentors. I'm also communicating with a lot of people. So it's very different from getting a master's program. And it is a lot, I'm still learning. If you have me back 4 years from now, I'll let you know how it goes.
Okay, sounds great. Thanks, Deborah. So in the interest of time, I'm actually going to combine a couple of topics together just to make sure we get to everything. So I wanted to ask what specific qualities or skills should someone have to become successful in each of your respective industries? And also, Deborah, you mentioned that you had applied to and, participated in several internships, and several of you have years of experience. So what are some of the challenges that you've all faced during your job search process, and how did you overcome them? And we can start with Funke.
Yeah. So skills you really need to be a program officer, research skills, I think Sean made a really good point. If you're recommending policies, you have to have evidence to back it up. You have to be like, these are the best practices. These are how many research studies have been done on this thing. You have to have the information. So a strong research background, definitely some project management and coordination skills, being able to like wrangle people and make sure that they're always on top of different things. And really relationship building. I communicate with global partners, with in-country partners, with government representatives. You have to be able to interact with these people and kind of adjust how you speak to them for different contexts. So I think those are the three big skills that you need. In terms of job search, I think you need to be a hustler. You need to reach out to your contacts and be like, I'm really interested in this position. I've saw it. These are my skills. Just like be a go-getter. I've gotten a ton of internships and jobs just by putting myself out there and being like, hey, saw your research. I have similar interests. Here is my like resume cover letter. You don't have a job, that's fine, but still would want to talk to you. So just having that hustler mentality, not giving up, and really believing in yourself and your ability to do whatever job you apply for.
Wonderful, thank you for sharing that insight on, the field of public health nutrition. And next, if either of the panelists want to speak about their experience, we can go back in order.
So basically, I agree with everything Funke has just said. I think networking is a huge part of it. I think I would say specifically in my field, networking is key, right? Because research or academic research, let me put it this way, is very small, right? And you're trying to climb a ladder without burning any bridges, right? So it's a difficult balance in that a lot of, especially when you get into academia, there are a lot of opportunities, right? And there, you have to find the balance between taking a lot on and it like overwhelming your plate, or taking a little and you're not exposing yourself enough. So you have to really have that balance of What can I take on my plate? What opportunities are available to me? And the key question is, how is this advancing my research? You always have to put yourself at the middle of it, right? You always have to think about, all right, these are all opportunities for me to expand my network, collaborate with certain stakeholders, certain mentors, but it has to be strategic, right? You have to think about, how is this gonna advance my research? So it's definitely a delicate balance, but I think, being open to opportunities, but also calculated in the way you accept those opportunities are key. But that's just like the little I wanted to chime in with that.
Great. And also with when it comes to public health communications, what does that look like, Khadija?
I would say this in terms of the skills that you need, being a good writer is one piece of the puzzle, but I also think that there are like softer skills that people don't often think about, but are really, really important if you're gonna like effectively communicate to people. And I would say that being perceptive is one of them, being really thoughtful is one of them, and being really creative is also something that comes up a lot. So being perceptive in the sense that you're insightful, and good at understanding situations and who's most impacted. And that's really important when it comes to forming strategies that actually speak to the problems that you want to solve for and the audience that you want to solve it in. And this is something, even though it's a softer skill, it is something that can be built, even just by reading up on the news and books and doing research on the topic, listening to panels with different perspectives and lenses, even tuning into like hours-long Clubhouse discussions to get like a sense of what people are saying about healthcare and vaccines, and you bring all of that with you when it comes to time to strategize and like critically think through what needs to happen. In terms of being thoughtful, I think that really entails thinking about how you say things, and it's having an understanding of both what you need to say and how your audiences will need to hear it in order to be reached and respond in the way that you want them to. And this is so important, I think, when it comes to health equity, or when you're talking about racial justice, and that comes up a lot in our work too, we really have to be better as a society in talking about and thinking about how we frame things and attribute responsibility in order to develop like the right solutions and say the right things. So that's really important. And then lastly, being creative is something that ties into both perception and thoughtfulness. And I think oftentimes when we're communicating about things or saying the same things over and over and over, honestly, but it's just to different audiences. And so at work, even if we're talking about a topic like K through 12 sex education, there's literally a million and one ways that we could say the same things, but you have to come in with the understanding that all million and one ways is not gonna reach the same audiences in the same way. So what I can effectively say to someone who lives in New York City in a more progressive place may be really different from what I need to say to someone who like lives in Mississippi, and get them to respond positively too. So, and even that can change on other like identity markers like race and sexual orientation and age and political party and just other vantage points that people might have. So you really have to just know who you're speaking to and be creative about the ways that you speak to them. And I think that's really important. And then in terms of navigating, I think you asked about navigating the job market. I would just echo what everyone said about networking. Find people on LinkedIn that are doing the work that you want to be doing, or even if you have friends, and just reach out to them and ask them questions about how they got to where they are. Talk to them about your interests. And that's so important because oftentimes people will remember those conversations. And if something, even if they don't have a role open, if something does come up, you'll be kind of top of mind for them to reach back out to or give a referral to even. So yeah.
Very helpful. Thank you, Khadija. That's great advice. And finally, we have Shalom, who is an international student with health experience in the healthcare consulting and pharma industry. And Shaloma, I was hoping you could touch on some of the skills that you found to be the most helpful in your role. And also, as an international student, what are some of those challenges you may have faced during your job search process and how you overcame them, if any?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Just like everyone said, I think the one thing I just wanted to highlight is I think for this kind of job or for even any kind of job that you're looking to get, I think having really strong analytical skills set you apart. Like even if it's how to create like tables, visuals on Excel, like I had to learn that on the job. And I think, because I mean, especially if you're having to work through like lots and lots of data, like your client doesn't want to see all of the data. They just want to see like, give me like this one page picture of what is going on. And sometimes you'd have to do that using a pivot table or like graphs or whatever it is. But like having those strong analytical skills would always come in handy on the job. And I also do think like something, I mean, I was lucky to have that because I had already worked in consulting, is like knowing how to write great emails. Like you never know how, you know, important that is till you start working on a job and then you write this email and your manager is like, this isn't clear. Could you like kind of like rewrite it? I mean, I used to be the kind of person that likes like 2-3 lines of email. And my manager is like, could you break it down a little bit more? And then you have to like write all of these things, like even though you're putting in like a lot more information, but it's very detailed and like very succinct as well. So finding that balance, I think those are like two, like, and also like really like being able to think like outside of the box or inside of the box or whatever they're saying now, but like thinking a little differently than you would think normally, you know, you have to like think quickly because like you might be like doing a presentation and then your client is asking you questions and you're like, oh, I totally like, wait, what are you saying? But like, so being able to like think on your feet, that is something that, you know, we never really learn in school, you know, but then you just have to like find a way to build that, you know, as you grow, as you go up like your career ladder. And I mean, my experience as an international student is definitely different from like people who are not. When I was like looking for a job, like it was very restrictive for me, and I'm going to be very transparent and honest with you guys, because I had to like prioritize like my stay back in America. Like I had to like prioritize companies that would like file my work visa, like do the green card for me. So that kind of like limited my options, right? So when I was like looking for a job, like I didn't have the liberty to be like, oh, I'm just going to take this job. Like I had to think about, I didn't get to get my work visa. Like, am I going to eventually like get a green card from this company? But I also didn't want to like shoot myself in the foot and like go to a place where I wouldn't be happy, you know? So I think I was lucky in that sense. But what I did was I started really early on, honestly. I think we graduated like May 2018. I started like applying to jobs in like summer of 2017, to be honest with you. Like I was very aggressive, like really, really aggressive, because I knew that I didn't have time. I had 90 days after graduation to get to like get a job. We graduated May 15th. I started working June 24th. So I just didn't have any breather in between. It was like back to back. And that can be, that was great for me, but then that also, like, you know, even now, because I've been thinking about, like, you know, when someone was talking about the job search, I think if you're my kind of person, the job search never ends, because, like, there's always something better, there's always something more, you know, I mean, even now in my career, I think I'm in a place where I'm, like, I need a change. I mean, I'm so comfortable, like, you can wake me up from my sleep and I'll like crunch like all these like large sets of data. But like, I think I'm on a plate where I need change. So the job search never ends, you know, but then you just have to find like a place that fits, you know, also that fits your, people don't think about it. Like you have to find a job that also fits your personality as well. You know, if you're the kind of person, like you like to talk, like communications might be great for you. I sit in front of the computer like day in, day out. And I think at this point, I'm so over it. I'm like, no, I don't want this anymore. You know, but, you know, if you're an international student and you're listening to me, you want to think about like your long-term stay. Thankfully, like power has changed hands. Sorry. I know when like with the former, like, I mean, I don't want to be shady, but it was horrible. Like thinking about everything I've gone through in the past 3 years, it was horrible. I mean, I feel a lot more comfortable now thinking about, like, you know, the change that has come to the government, like, now. So you have to think about, like, you'll stay here. Like, do you want to stay back? If you want to stay back, then you want to be intentional about looking out for companies, organizations that are willing to, like, keep you long term, you know. And I think the one thing is, there are a lot of these companies, I think you just have to look harder, you know, if you want to not do the trend, because I'm not doing, like, the traditional, like, public health kind of, like, work. Like, there are a lot of jobs in the tech industry for, like, especially now. And I think we're going to talk about that later on, how the job market has changed. Like, you know, I've had to talk to recruiters looking for, like, help policy analysts at Facebook or at Google or at, like, you know, all these other companies. So you have to, like, think broadly, like, what exactly do I want? What kind of industry do I want? Do I want to be at a company, like, for 30 years, for 10, 20 years? Or do I want to be, am I the kind of person who likes to, like, move from company to company? So that would, like, determine, like, how you look for, search for jobs. Sorry, I said too much.
Oh, that's all so helpful. And it gives us so many different points to jump off from. But so you all sort of had this running theme in that, you know, you mentioned networking and mentorship is important. I believe Khadija and Deborah mentioned that. And so I was wondering if you could all share, whoever wants to share, how you go about finding mentors. What message should you send? What should the outreach look like? And where do you find these mentors?
I can start. In general, I think Funke had alluded to that earlier. You just shoot them an email. If you're interested in their work, send a cold email. LinkedIn is your friend. Everyone's on there. You can learn a lot about what people are working on in real time, what they're doing. I have several mentors, right? So it's not just one person. You have to kind of plan and figure out what are different aspects of my life that I want mentorship in. Is it career mentor, academic mentor, personal mentor? So I have several mentors, right? And a lot of the ways that I have found my mentors is really just, you know, informal interviewing, even if it's not for a job. I just want to learn more about their research or learn more about the work that they're doing. Those are the kind of ways I kind of reach out to people. A second way is that the mentors I already have, I ask them about some of the things I'm interested in, and they refer me. They're like, hey, I have this mentee who's interested in blah, blah, blah. Can you meet with her for X amount of time? And that's another way to build mentorship. So I have one of my main mentors, I actually found by going to a seminar. So I happened to be at a seminar, and I think he just attended or had made some comments, and I just walked up to him and, you know, told him about myself. Another key thing that I would say one should have are business cards, right? So I think through Wasserman, you can get those. I'm not sure. Kristen, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but always have those on you. You don't know where you're going to meet these people. I've met a ton of mentors at conferences, international conferences in the US. And one of the ways they usually remembered me is how I approached them, one. And also they have some way to contact me, right? If you just have this conversation with someone and you're like, blah, 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 you need to have that form of contact and giving out a business card or finding them on LinkedIn and connecting, like, hey, we had this conversation, blah, blah, blah. So those are one of the two main ways to summarize: cold email, one. Two, your base of mentors, have them refer you. And three, when you go out to these networking events like seminars, conferences, be ready to actually meet those people. So those are the three ways I would say for me that I've built that mentorship base.
Wow, I 100% agree with Debbie. And also just pay attention when you're joining webinars, when you're joining conferences, or like when you're going to conferences, pay attention to the people who are around you and do your research, because you never know who you're going to interact with. If there's somebody even on this call right now, you're like, oh, I like what they're doing. Go and do your research. Find out more about them, find out more about their work, and then message them. I feel like people are so afraid to like cold email someone because they're like, oh, I don't know how this is going to end. If you don't do anything, you're never going to build that relationship. Just be willing to put yourself out there and try to form these connections. And also when you do find someone you're interested in talking to, make sure you keep in contact with them. Don't just like email them once and have one conversation, but make sure you're forming a relationship. Build that connection. I feel like a lot of time people don't do that.
Yeah, to add on to what Funke said, a lot of those mentors that I have, when I write a new paper or I get published somewhere, I always share my work with them. So the base of my mentorship was to learn more about research, and the product of that research, either through a paper or through an abstract, I always share with them. Or even like, if I'm on a panel like this, I usually tell them about it, like, hey, I'm on this panel. If you can join in, please do. So that's another way I would say you can keep in contact. Whatever products from your work you have, always share the, share it with them if you can.
I think the only thing that I would add is, well, I think of mentorship is just forming a community in whatever space you're in. And so we also have to think about people who are maybe on our level or not super far up away from us, who can also be mentors or part of your personal board of directors and all that kind of stuff. When I think about when I started at Planned Parenthood, like the people who really took me under my wings were my peers. And so I think there's a lot to be gained from people who maybe don't have tons and tons of experience, but can also still be a guiding light for you in your career. So.
Awesome. I found that, like, in my experience, a lot of students tend to want mentors that either look like them or mentors that make them feel comfortable in some way. And given everything that's going on recently with, you know, COVID-19 and the racial relations that are, you know, impacting our communities, I was wondering if you all could touch on sort of how these recent events are affecting the way that you work. And the way that you think about work and some strategies that you have for self-care. You know, we're all going through things and a lot is happening. So if you all could share how you advocate for communities of color and within your space, how you deal with microaggressions or otherwise how you advocate for diversity in the field.
Yeah, I mean, I can go and I'm going like, you know, so I work in a very predominantly like non-Black environment, if you get what I mean. I think I can count on my one finger. Like, this is like a company that has over 300 people. And I don't think we're like up to probably like 15 Black people in the company. So you can imagine the kind of like environment I work with. And I clearly remember like when, you know, after George Floyd's death and everything that happened in that season, I remember the week after, like at my team meeting, I was expecting like my manager to say something and like she didn't say anything. And I think I cried afterwards. Like, I felt so bad. Like, it was horrible because when I was thinking about my friends who worked in other companies and other companies that were more diverse, because like I was talking to my friends and they were like, oh my God, like, you know, my manager was so compassionate. Like, there were conversations around it and it wasn't okay. And, you know, some of the Black people in my company, like, we had to write a letter to, like, we came together and wrote a letter to the company, like, this is not okay, like, you cannot not say something. And then, like, you know, one of the managing partners, like, sent out an email to the entire company, you know, saying something, but that, like, we shouldn't have done that, like, you know, it was, like, why, but I do definitely think that, you know, I mean, I was not the one who came up with the initiative to write the letter, but, like, I was so grateful to whoever, like, did that, because what that meant was that immediately afterwards, a diversity work group was set up at the company, right, you know, and for the first time, like, you know, I've been seeing these emails, because this is Black History Month, I've been seeing these emails, like, celebrating Black people for the first time in 3 years since I joined the company. So I think that was like the game changer, the fact that some people decided to stand up and speak up. You know, I mean, I think like, you know, there's this like running joke in the Bay Area that says like the Bay Area is like seemingly is like the most diverse, like one of the most diverse places, but like the kind of microaggressions here, like, it's crazy. But yeah, and I mean, I think, you know, even all of that, like, I had to take a step back and ask myself, you know, how, you know, is this somewhere I want to be long-term? Like, you know, how does this impact me as a Black? I mean, I am an international student, so I cannot even 100% relate to, like, you know, some of the struggles of, like, Black people who were born here and grew up here all their lives. But then I in a certain sense, I understand it. And, you know, I do definitely think that, you know, that's something you have to navigate, especially if you're, like, in consulting, like, you know, in a place that is predominantly, like, not Black, you know, you just have to navigate, like, I've had to deal with, like, crazy microaggressions, I've had to deal with people, like, double checking my work, like, how, like, I'm like, what, like, you know, and, you know, all these things, you know, you think that, oh, if I work harder, people will respect me, but not really, like, you have to respect me because I'm me, like, you shouldn't have to respect me because I have to put in, like, 10 times the work that other people are putting in for you to respect me. So, I mean, you just have to find ways to cope. I mean, I'm also grateful to my company. Like, we have all of these, like, you know, resources where you have to, like, talk to, like, a therapist or, like, you know, yoga and all of that. Whatever it is that works for you, you have to, like, find ways to, like, you know, cope through all of it. I mean, for me, I've been working from home since last year, March. Like, I haven't stepped into the office for almost a year now. And I, you know, it's not been the easiest, you know, but, you know, I think, like, I was doing so well at the beginning. I was like, oh my God, I'm so happy. I'm at home. I set up my work desk and everything. And then halfway into it, I had, like, a whole mental breakdown. I'm like, I'm so over this, you know, but then just being that person where you're like, you know what, how do I take a step back? Even taking time off work in the pandemic, like, I would take time off work and literally just relax at home and do other things aside from work. And yeah, so yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, Samara, I agree with you. Thank you. We appreciate your candor. Yes, if any of the other panelists have something to add to that.
Yeah, I can add something. So there's something called the minority tax, right? And this comes to mind by what Shalom said around having to work 10 times harder for the same amount of work that someone who doesn't look like you would just do, and that would be appreciated. So there's something called the minority tax and the majority subsidy. So I have felt that minority tax in the work I've had to do, right? So I had to make sure that I am doing these 10 things. I'm making sure I'm putting myself at the forefront. I'm making sure that I have to do X, Y, Z. I have to focus on being perfect, right? So that's the tax that I've been experiencing throughout my journey as a Black woman in academia that, you know, is somewhat inevitable in that you do kind of have to do that to be appreciated, but it shouldn't be, right? So it's really having or coming to the realization that this is what it is, somewhat accepting it, but also speaking up about it. So one thing that I would applaud NYU, especially NYU Langone for, was that they actually did acknowledge you know, what happened over summer around George Floyd and all the conversations we had around Black Lives Matter. And I really, really appreciated it. Beyond just, you know, sending an email, the dean of the school, that's Grossman, actually has invested dollars into setting up an Institute for Excellence in Health Equity. And that's gonna be led by Dr. Bingo Gedigbe. And the goal of that particular institute is to make sure there's health equity in everything that NYU Langone is doing. So having not only people of color, but Black and Brown faculty at all levels, ensuring that all institutes recruit and retain Black students, Black medical students, ensuring that we're engaging with communities of color, and, you know, ensuring that diversity is at the top of NYU's goals. So NYU has four goals. The fifth pillar, which was just added this past summer, was the health equity goal. So I think if anything, this past summer brought the conversation forward and also kept it there, in that we are more than comfortable to have these conversations now, or rather I would say I feel more comfortable to have these kind of conversations now everywhere, right? It is now normalized. It's no longer, oh, this person is complaining about all their struggles. We are slowly, I would say, accepting the reality of what America is, right? Be it in academia, in consulting, global health, whatever it is, we have to start having these conversations everywhere. One of the ways I deal with it is putting myself in front of it, right? When I got to, let me backtrack. I was lucky enough to be working in a center that was very, very diverse. That's the Center for Health and Behavior Change. That's why I was a senior program coordinator. When I transitioned into becoming a student, I went from a very diverse place to only where three of us are Black in the entire cohort. So what I've done is to continuously speak up about how to retain Black students, how to recruit Black students, how to make them understand that it's a problem when there are not a lot of people of color in these fields. So one of the ways that I've coped with it is by speaking up. That's not for everyone, but that's one of the ways I have coped with that.
Yes, that was so very well said. Thank you for sharing. And so now, as we sort of wrap up, and before we get to questions for you all, for our panelists, I wanted to ask one final one. And that was, you know, how has the pandemic that we're all living in influenced the job market in public health? And how should new graduates prepare when entering the job market? If anyone would like to share. Or if you could all think of maybe certain resources from NYU that you'd like to share that have contributed to your success.
I can go, and I think, yeah, sorry. I do think that, you know, and I mean, I say this with every sense of like humility and, you know, just like knowing that there's some people who are not in the same position. I do think that like in a certain sense for people in healthcare, there's just been a lot of jobs available. I mean, I know like, you know, friends who lost their jobs, but like, honestly, I cannot count the number of recruiters that reached out to me in the past year or so. Like it's been job back to back in the pharmaceutical industry, even in tech as well. Like I've had to apply to jobs that said like policy, healthcare policy analyst at Facebook or Google or whatever that is. So I do think there are a lot of opportunities for us to grow as public health professionals, because you have to think about what happened. Like the world wasn't ready for this. Like nobody was. Like they were literally like, everyone was in shock when all of this happened. So that means there's need for people who can think a little deeply about like, you know, how can we set up like structures in our communities that would not allow us be in this kind of position in 10 years time, you know, especially for the generation coming like behind us, like, and all of that is policy work. I mean, you have to think about like different states and how they manage all of these issues. I mean, I think California was the worst, like we managed it horribly. And that goes back to like, not like riding on the back of research and like evidence-based, like, you know, conversations or policy. Like, you know, why don't we have like all of these policies to drive like the kind of work we're doing around everything that is going on now? So I do think that like, you know, there's a lot of opportunities for us as public health people to fit in and have our voices being heard, you know, in this, like in our communities or like, you know, in our states or wherever we are, you know, especially now that we have like a more like, we have a president who's willing to listen to like research. So find a way to fit yourself in, like, you know, CDC, wherever, you know, in research, if you want to do consulting or whatever that is, there's just definitely something for you or somewhere for you to fit yourself in. The most important thing to ask yourself is, what are the skills I need to get myself to where I want to be? But are these jobs available? Absolutely, there are a ton of them available out there. And you know, once you use LinkedIn, like once your LinkedIn page is updated, like these recruiters will literally like be knocking at your doors. Like they will be calling you all the time to ask you if you're available for this job. So I definitely do think that that's something to think about. And I mean, when I was at NYU, I used Wasserman a lot. And I think that really helped me, like, you know, build my resume, because I was coming from Nigeria. Like the way my resume was formatted when I moved out here is not the way it is now. So I needed that help and that guidance to see, okay, how do things work in this particular system? And how can I fit myself to, like, you know, be able to like say, oh, I'm a valuable like person that you can hire who would bring value to the table to your organization.
Just to go off what Shalom said, there are a lot of healthcare jobs available, but they may not be in the areas that you think you're interested in. Like right now, I know if you're probably thinking about getting into the public health nutrition space, there's not a lot of jobs out there. But I think Debbie said something earlier that I thought was really good. You need to be open to opportunities, but be strategic in what you choose. So if you cannot find a job that's specifically in the area you're interested in, look at these other jobs and see, what can I pull from this? If there's a policy analyst job, what can I pull from this job? And how can I translate it into what I want, or where I want to take myself in the future? So just be very strategic in the jobs that you do apply for, even if they're not in the areas that you think you want to be in. How can they be applied to your future?
I think one thing I'd want to add, just given the fact that we're all women and we're all Black women, a lot of studies show that men tend to apply for jobs that they're not necessarily qualified for. And women usually feel like they have to have 80% of the skills before they do apply. But I am of the belief that I just apply, and I'm sure something will stick. So in terms of applying to schools, in terms of finding mentors, in terms of seeking out opportunities, I put myself out there, right? So it's very important for, you know, us as women, specifically even us as Black women, to apply to those jobs. Even when you read the job description, don't feel like you have to check off all the qualifications or all of the things. No, just apply and see what happens. So that's one thing I wanted to add in.
I would say I'm really optimistic that you all will be able to find what you want to do in due time. And I agree with what Deborah mentioned about applying to all roles, like anything that piques your interest, especially just because most of what you will end up doing, you're going to learn when you get there. And so most of the skills you'll build are going to be built on the job. And so I think what's most important is showing why you want to be there and why what draws you to the organization and its mission and its goals, and then you'll be able to figure out the rest later, I think. And in terms of resources at NYU, I will say that I was able to get a really awesome mentor at NYU, Dr. Dill. Who was absolutely phenomenal, and someone who, she was my thesis advisor, but someone I still have a relationship with to this day, and someone who helped with Black Women's Health or Black Women's Health Collective and all the things like during that last semester. And so I would say try to build relationships with your professors who might also be a good gateway for opportunities for you too.
I think this is important to mention. I actually found my job through the newsletter for NYU. So look at the jobs that they send out. Look at those newsletters. Definitely use Wasserman and any, or build relationship with your professors, because they can really help you with your job search as well.
Yeah, to add to that, I was able to get my job through interning. So as I had mentioned earlier, I had interned in a bunch of places, and I actually had been given two offers from both internships. So it was a decision between one or the other. So I would say another way to kind of get your feet wet in that regard is, you know, while you're during the MPH program, a lot of the classes are in the evening. During the day, be interning, right? Go out and, you know, volunteer here and there. And the great thing about NYU and the medical school is that there are a bunch of people doing amazing projects, and a lot of them are looking for students. Even some of the projects that I'm on are looking for, you know, postdoctoral students, graduate students. So it's always important to put yourself out there. Even if you're not earning money, I think you're gaining skills from that experience as well. That could definitely be tough, just given the fact that we're in a pandemic, you know, a lot of people need income. But I think if you can dedicate like 20 hours to an internship, it could pay off in the future as well. And one more thing I wanted to add that Khadija mentioned was that you learn most of the things on the job. So there's no amount of courses or classes that you're going to take that's ever going to prepare you for the for whatever job you get, right? So I think if anything, the graduate program just helps you thrive in whatever job you end up getting. It helps you navigate difficult situations. It gives you opportunities to know how to access resources. It doesn't necessarily prepare you for the job because you're going to learn everything on the job, but it gives you like a solid foundation that'll help you thrive. So that's one other thing I wanted to add.
Awesome. Thank you all for that wealth of information. It was so helpful, I'm sure. I hope that the attendees have found this helpful and have been listening in and hopefully started drafting some questions they wanted to ask. So if anyone has anything, any burning question they want to ask now, feel free to raise your hand and we will spotlight you and you can ask your question. Or if you feel more comfortable just putting it in the chat, we'll read it aloud as well. Anyone have any questions? Okay, in the meantime, we can go to one final question. We can just give one final piece of advice to anyone. If you all would like reflect on your experience thus far, if you could think of one thing you would offer to any young alumni or current student on something they could do now to succeed in your industry later on.
I think one thing I'm gonna say, so for some people, they were able to get a job right away. For other people, it took 6 months. So one thing I'm gonna say to people is that it will come. For some people, it might take time, but just know that. Because at some point I had some friends that were like, what was the point of even getting an MPH? I'm unemployed. And that was pre-pandemic, right? So one thing that I want everyone that who's listening to me right now is that it will come. If you're looking for a job, trust me when I say it will come. Just make sure you're still applying. Don't ever stop applying. That's the key, but it will come. For some people, the average for MPH holders on average is about 6 months. I don't know how that might've changed through COVID, but just trust me when I say it will come. That's just one, you know, piece of advice I wanted to share.
I think my piece of advice was don't buy into imposter syndrome. I think oftentimes, especially as a Black woman, you get into these white spaces and you're just like, oh my God, what do I know? Am I even an expert in this? You were hired for a reason. You have this job for a reason. You need to believe in yourself. And like, just like Khadija said, everyone is learning on the job. So don't let imposter syndrome affect how you move in your life and what positions you apply for, how you speak up at work. Just know it's not a real thing.
Yeah, I also just, oh, sorry, Khadija, did you want to go? Oh, okay. I think I also wanted to add, just like, I mean, I really wanted to piggyback on what like Funke said about like imposter syndrome. And I'm just going to share this quick story. Listen, the first time I did my performance review with my manager, like when she was saying all these nice things about me, I cried. Like I was shocked because I had struggled for 6 months, like asking myself if I was worth it. I was doubting my ability. I was doubting. I mean, I'm a smart girl. Like, why was I doubting myself? You know, I struggled with that for the longest time. And that was when I had to like start like thinking and figuring out who I was going to get as a mentor. And it was hard for me because there was really no Black woman in like my company that I could talk to. So I had to like do this whole external thing to get someone who could talk me through like how I was feeling. And, you know, like, and she was like, you're not the only one in this position. So I had to find a way to like get through that. And I think what I wanted to say is like, be very gentle with yourself. You know, this is a very interesting season. And I think like it gets easy to like, especially when you're graduating and like, you know, it gets easy to like beat yourself at the back and be like, oh my God, like, you know, what kind of job am I going to get? Like, what am I going to do next? How am I going to fit into this world? How am I going to pay off all my loans? You know, what is going to happen? And that is like the questions that come to your head. But I'm just going to say, be very gentle with yourself. And I mean, sometimes the next level you're looking for, it's inside of you. You have to create that next level for yourself. You know, sometimes we're looking to all of this like organizations to be like, oh, I want to get a job. But what if you're supposed to start your own thing? What if you're supposed to like do your own thing? I mean, there are amazing women who finished with us who like, I mean, I think Ashley is one of them. She built this whole like health in, you know, Hue or something, you know. So sometimes that next level is inside of you. You have to create that table for yourself and create like your own seat at your own table. So
yes, love it. Thank you. We actually had a question. I saw Adeze. Please pronounce me if you
My name's Adeze.
Adeze. Yes.
Yeah, actually Shalom and Funke kind of answered my questions for me. I was, because I've been told before, it's popped up a lot that public health isn't a field dominated by a lot of Black women. So I was going to ask what your mentality, like, did you have to change your mentality mentally and emotionally in order to deal with such a work environment?
Yes, 100%. I feel like I've always been a very strong person, but entering like the globe, especially the global health space, it is a space that's dominated by white people, especially white men making the decision and the decisions. And you really, really have to believe in yourself. I know for me, like just an example of my experience, the job I have now, I had to make them give it to me. Before I was a program associate, I was overqualified. I was doing the work of people who were two or three levels higher than me. And the first time I asked for a raise, they basically said, why do you think you deserve that? And I like went into the bathroom and I cried. And then I had to realize these people only will do this to you if you allow them to do it. So I went back and I was like, hey, we've been talking about this a lot, but I want to let you know, if I'm not going to grow here, I'm going to leave. And maybe a week later, they gave me that promotion because they knew that they needed me to do that work. And you just really, really have to like remember that, actually, this is probably inappropriate, but remember, you're a bad bitch. You are, you are the best, and people need to view you as how you view yourself, and don't ever let somebody else tell you what your worth is. You decide your worth.
Yes, we love that. On that note, we're going to go ahead and conclude the event. We are way over time, but I believe we had such a great productive conversation today. And I just want to give a big thank you to our panelists for their time today, as well as to the audience for your attention. If you're comfortable, panelists, because I know we still have a few hands raised. If you're comfortable, you could email me your contact info and we'll get it out to the attendees so that they can follow up with you. And to our attendees, if you like this chat or if you're interested in any of these careers, definitely check out the Career Expo on March 5th. You should have received communication from NYU about that. And thanks again, everyone. I really, really appreciate all of your time and I hope everyone has a great rest of your week. Gonna take it over to Kristen.
Yes, I mean, I can't say any more than you did. Please show some love to our amazing panelists. It's so amazing for you to join us.